When I was a kid, we called it English class, but today the lingo has slightly changed and it's now referred to as ELA. It stands for English Language Arts. So when you hear ELA, think English class. What we're looking at right now is the district curriculum for 10th grade ELA students. It's an overview for all the lessons and the units for the entire school year. This particular unit has an overarching theme of activism. In fact, for the first 5 weeks of school, kids are exploring the concept of activism. And for the next few minutes, we're going to take a look at a lesson in which students are working with the famous speech by the Swedish activist Greta Thunberg. You heard of her. And you've probably heard this speech, or at least you've heard scraps of it. Any road, let's take a look.
What's your message to world leaders today?
My message is that we'll be watching you. This is all wrong. I shouldn't be up here. I should be back in school on the other side of the ocean. Yet you all come to us young people for hope. How dare you? You have stolen my dreams and my childhood with your empty words, and yet I'm one of the lucky ones. People are suffering. People are dying. Entire ecosystems are collapsing. We are in the beginning of a mass extinction, and all you can talk about is money and fairy tales of eternal economic growth. How dare you?
So this lesson has an emphasis on rhetoric. Rhetoric is one of the tools for persuasive communication, and that can come in the form of a written essay or in a speech. Well, one thing I've noticed about teenagers, in a general sense, is they seem to have a pretty good filter for what's authentic and what's artificial. And since Greta is in the same approximate age range as the students getting this lesson, I'm interested to know how they relate to her, how they receive her message and respond to her delivery. So thus far, I kind of like this activity. Now, Greta spends the bulk of the speech explaining her understanding and her prediction of the climate science, which is catastrophic. At least that's how I would describe it. If you want to see the entire clip, I'll leave a link to it down below. But for now, I would just prefer to skip ahead and get to some of the most dynamic parts of the speech.
You are failing us. But the young people are starting to understand your betrayal. The eyes of all future generations are upon you. And if you choose to fail us, I say we will never forgive you.
I don't really care for that part. I admit that there is an authoritative ring to it and it has a powerful weight that is impressive to me coming from such a young person. But I don't think an unforgiving attitude is a good attitude for teenagers to adopt. It sounds kind of threatening. And who is she to never forgive people? And for what? Using fuel? That's not a war crime. I know that the stakes are high and we only have one planet left and I don't want to see it destroyed. But philosophically, I don't like it. Just not my favorite moment in the speech.
We will not let you get away with this. Right here, right now, is where we draw the line. The world is waking up. And change is coming, whether you like it or not. Thank you.
The first thing that occurred to me with this lesson was the lack of instruction on the mechanics of writing. It's an English language arts class, yet there's nothing about the nuts and bolts of composition writing. And students are scoring relatively low in literacy these days, so they could use some extra support on the technical side of writing. But yet, this lesson seems to, as far as I can tell, only ask students to casually discuss the style and the tone of Greta's speech. Personally, I felt a great deal of passion and authenticity in her delivery, and it's my belief that she cares deeply about this topic. And she's a teenager at the time of this speech, and she's speaking to a rather large audience, you know, the world, that's all. So give her a few points for that, because public speaking is not easy. In fact, I heard it's kind of hard. But this is where it gets a little difficult to talk about, because I believe that the urgency with which she conveys her message is partially predicated on a misunderstanding. I think that her message is closely tied to another message that we heard several years ago that said the world is going to end in 12 years. But there's a problem with this worldview, because it was not the case that the scientists of the world just all came together and discovered this deadline out there in the atmosphere. It was not that precise of a scientific measurement. There was a UN climate report from 2018 in which some scientists urged world leaders to cut emissions by 2030. And 30 minus 18, of course, is 12, which is where we get the 12 years from. But 2030 was picked as an ambitious target year. It was picked as a goal to add seriousness to the movement. And yet some certain news outlets decided to report it as the Earth has 12 years to avert a climate catastrophe.
But getting back to this specific question, the 2018 IPCC report, which was a special report commissioned to learn about the difference between 1.5 degrees of warming and 2, which sounds so weird and technocratic and complicated, that's the one that generated the whole meme about 8 years left.
12 years.
Till doomsday. Then,
yeah, it was 2013.
And that's the one. The meme? This was the idea that there's a point we're going to, if we don't cut emissions in half by whatever it was, 2050, yeah, we're doomed. That emerged from that specific report. And it wasn't something that was in the report. It was in the spin around the report. And that's what captivated Greta appropriately as a young person going, you know, and with her unique vantage point and stuff. And that report, I still need to dig in and write something deeper about what happened with that particular dynamics, created this recent burst of we're doomed rhetoric that I think you're focusing on. And it's all in the external interpretations, which journalism laps up because we're looking for the front page thought.
Now, this is just according to my memory, but it seems to me that this was the approximate time when some in the news media began to more often attribute weather events to climate change. For instance, if it was too dry in California, that's evidence of climate change. If it's too wet in California, that's evidence of climate change. And if the weather was in the range of normal, that's also attributable to climate change. You know who's pretty good at talking about this type of stuff and might actually offer a rational alternative view on it? It's a guy called Bjorn Lomborg. I just believe Bjorn Lomborg has a more complete picture of the effects of climate change, yet it's not framed in a way to terrify people or to instill eco-anxiety among kids. On the contrary, he's optimistic about the future, he's solution-oriented, and he bases it all on cost-benefit analysis. To be sure, Bjorn Lomborg clearly states that climate change is an issue to be taken seriously, there are harmful effects to a warming world, and regrettably, sadly, it's mostly caused by human civilization. So Lomborg is not one to go against the flow of climate science, and he's not someone dealing in alternative facts.
You know, there's absolutely global warming. It is an issue, and it's probably just worthwhile to get it out of the way.
It's an issue, and it's caused by humans.
It's caused by humans, yeah.
Well, Bjorn Lomborg also writes that the effects of climate change have been massively exaggerated. Some of the news media have built a business model for reporting the worst interpretation of climate science possible, when in reality, it's not nearly that bad. And there's no scientific reason to expect climate Armageddon.
But on the other hand, I think to an extent, increasing extent, we've gotten into a world where a lot of people really think this is the, you know, the end of the times. Yes. So the OECD did a new survey of all OECD countries, and it's shocking. So it shows that 60% of all people in the OECD, so the rich world, believes that global warming will likely or very likely lead to the extinction of mankind. And that's scary in a very, very clear way. Because look, if this really is true, if global warming is this meteor hurtling towards Earth, and you know we're going to be destroyed in 12 years or whatever the number is today, then clearly we should care about nothing else. But that's not the way it is. This is not actually what the UN climate panel tells us or anything else. So I think it's not so much about arguing against the people who are saying it's a hoax. That's not really where I am. I don't think that's where Andy or really where the conversation is. But it is a question of sort of pulling people back from this end of the world conversation. Because
first of all, contrary to the conventional thinking and the usual reporting, natural disasters have not increased on a global scale. I know that they're difficult to count, and the climate models do predict an increase in the frequency and the intensity of natural disasters, but there's been no big observable spike in hurricanes, floods, wildfires, or droughts, and the data in Lomborg's book is all drawn from the IPCC, the climate scientists of the UN. It also should come as a relief that climate-related deaths are way down over the last 100 years. Now, there has been an increase in damage due to climate-related events, but that has far more to do with the quadrupling of the population and an increase in infrastructure in these high-risk places. In other words, more people are building more homes in places that historically have taken a beating from hurricanes and floods.
Pakistan, in 1960, I just looked these data up, there were 40 million people in Pakistan. Today, there are 225 million. And a big chunk of them are still rural. They live in the floodplain of the amazing Indus River, which comes down from the Himalayas. Extraordinary 5,000-year history of agriculture there. But when you put 200 million people in harm's way, and this doesn't say anything about the bigger questions about, oh, shame on Pakistan for having more people. It just says the reality is the losses that we see in the news are, and the science finds this, even though there's a new weather attribution group, it's WX Risk on Twitter, this does pretty good work on how much of what just happened was some tweak in the storm from global warming, from CO2 changing weather. But the reports also have a section on, by the way, the vulnerability that was built in this region was a big driver of loss. So discriminating between loss, change in what's happening on the ground, and change in the climate system is never solely about CO2. Climate change is up here. Disasters are on the ground. They depend on how many people are in the way, how much stuff you built in the way. And so far, we've done so much of that so fast in the 20th century, particularly, that it completely dominates. It makes it hard, impossible to discriminate how much of that disaster was from the change in weather from global warming.
Now, this might be an unrelated or an unimportant detail, but I felt it was worth mentioning. Far more people die from the cold than from the heat. It's counterintuitive because heat waves are miserable and they're deadly, but they don't last as long as the winter, and they're a lot less deadly than the winter. And it requires more continuous energy to heat a home throughout the winter. There's another idea in Bjorn Lomborg's book, and even though it's a lesser pronounced theme throughout the book, I still wanted to talk about it. It's the idea that there's a list of about 40 other environmental issues that rank higher than climate change with regard to imminence, seriousness, and severity. And these issues are more tangible, and they're more within the reach of humanity to alleviate. It's things like overfarming, overfishing, habitat loss, access to clean, drinkable water, corrupt governments, animal cruelty, all of which are more visible to the world, and if we address those, there's a greater payoff than merely relying on some minuscule cuts to emissions.
But one of the biggest concerns about climate change right now is the effects that it will have on the natural world. So should we really deprioritize climate change mitigation at the risk of severely harming biodiversity, for example?
So biodiversity is a huge issue, but everyone, including the World Wildlife Fund and everybody else, will argue that climate change is not the main driver of this. This is agricultural usage, it's invasive species, it's encroachment from cities, it's the fact that we use a lot more for farming land. Those are the main issues for biodiversity. And all of these solutions are mostly about getting people out of poverty. That is, if you're ineffective and if you have lots of human stressors, you basically, you know, cut down forest. If you're rich, and we see this very clearly in rich countries, for instance, we're reforesting because we can afford to.
So now, I say all these things against the certainty of climate change, because the climate is changing, but it's not the only thing that changes. Human ingenuity, innovation, technology, wealth. The world is getting wealthier, and as GDPs rise, countries have an easier time adapting to extreme weather. So if the message of catastrophic climate change is being taught to kids in their English classes, I don't see why we can't temper that a little bit with some of the facts that Bjorn Lomborg covers. And why exactly would we want to teach teenagers to be more cynical than they already are? It's already in their nature. And I'm just not convinced that it's good for a kid's psychology to get them all worked up over the climate apocalypse.
So I think, yeah, I totally understand why Greta Thunberg is doing what she's doing. I have great respect for her because, if you know, I look at a lot of kids growing up and they're basically being told, you're not going to reach adulthood, or at least not, you're not going to get very far into adulthood. And that, of course, you know, this is the meteor hurtling towards Earth. And then this is the only thing we should be focusing on. I understand why she's making that argument. I think it's, at the end of the day, it's incorrect. And I'm sure we'll get around to talking about that. And one of the things is, of course, that her whole generation, you know, I can understand why they're saying, you know, if we're going to be dead in 12 years, why would I want to study? You know, why would I really care about anything? So I totally want to sort of pull Greta and many others out of this end of the world fear, but I totally get why she's doing it. I think she's done a service in the sense that she's gotten more people to talk about climate. And that's good because we need to have this discussion.